they probably won't be telling us anything. Peter Mead, it's been an interesting year. I know probably you can't tell us who you think might win, but who do you think might be some of the chances, some of the better players you've seen this year?
Well, I think Tony McGuinness, Bruce. But if I was looking for another one, Michael Graham. And for a real roughie, although it's not that rough really, John Riley.
Right, so Graham, McGuinness and Riley. Now, what about your mate Desi Foster? Is he about or is he still in hiding?
Des, you see them all throughout the year. What sort of a player do you look for?
Well, I think really, as the award states, the fairest and most brilliant. And that's the sort of player I think you look for. And we've got to look for it. I think we extend it a bit to the team man, the guy that does all the hard work.
Neil, a disappointing end to the season for Westies, but as far as the medal is concerned, who do you like?
Well, first off, yes, a disappointing finish, Sandy. I think there's about anyone of about eight players that have a real good chance. I'd say McGuinness, Kernahan from Glenelg. I'd say Naley from South Adelaide, Graham from Sturt, Platten from Central, Borchard from West, Phillips from Port. I'd be surprised if the winner didn't come out of that group.
Harry, you could be forgiven for being a little toey tonight. Your son must have a chance in the medal.
I'm not sure about that, Sandy. I think he's had a pretty reasonable year, but when you come to win the Magarey medals, that's a fairly big statement, or expect him to, you know, have a show on that.
Well, Tony McGuinness is another youngster,
yes,
at the Bay.
Tony's done very, very well, and I would think at this stage that if either one of those do go close, they're about the only two in the club that might.
Jeff, we've had four players, or three, that have kicked 100 and one that's almost kicked 100, but not many full forwards win Magarey medals. Could you see an upset from a full forward?
Well, Freddie Phyllis did it some years ago, and I suppose it's a chance, but in view of the relatively few number of times that they handle the ball, I think it really would be a huge upset to have one of them win it.
One of the favourites for the medal, dubbed by the press anyway, Michael Graham. Mike, how have you assessed your season?
Well, it's playing on the ball, Sandy. I've got a few more kicks than I normally get. I think the main reason everyone's sort of saying it's been a good year for me is, and that's the reason, is because I've been on the ball.
Mark, you're another one of the players that the scribes have jotted down as a favourite. How do you rate your chances?
Not too good. I just had a bet then with Bainesy over here that I wouldn't be in the top 10. So hopefully I won't be in the top 10.
Can you see the medalist coming from West Adelaide?
I think Ian Borchard, our captain, at top our poll. Mike Smith, unfortunately, suspended. And I think Tony Burgess and Grant Bilkley, I think they'd probably be our best. But I'd go for Ian Borchard, the best of our players.
Neil, you're no doubt over some of the pressure of yesterday's win over Sturt. You've seen your club in action all year. Who do you think could take out the medal?
Well, to be quite frank, I really haven't got any idea. I think it'll be a very, very close count. I wouldn't like to hazard a guess.
Jeff, how do you rate your son's chances?
Oh, I think Peter's had a pretty reasonable season since he's played this year, but I don't rate his chances high about winning it. It would be magnificent if he would, but I think it may be a little bit beyond him at this point of time.
Peter, what do you think of Dad's comments?
I think they're pretty right, Sandy.
Well, who do you like?
I'd like to see Michael win it more than anything, because he's from the club, but I've heard that Naley and Tony McGuinness have had fair seasons as well.
Like his father, very modest. Gentlemen, have a good night.
Channel 7 and the South Australian National Football League proudly bring you the 1982 Magarey Medal presentation. From the Old Lion Hotel, North Adelaide, the official counting of votes and announcement of the fairest and most brilliant player in the South Australian National Football League for season 1982. Could Glenelg Rover Tony McGuinness become the youngest player ever to win the Magarey medal? Could Michael Graham win and capture that record held by Jeff Motley? Could Mark Naley be the first Panther to win since the great Jim Dean? Is there a chance that Russell Ebert could win his fifth medal? Could young Stephen Kernahan become the first ruckman to win since John Marriott in 1951? Or could rookie Peter Motley poll well enough to give us the first ever father and son Magarey medal winners? A fascinating set of possibilities to consider as we await the count that will decide who wins South Australia's most prized football award. your hosts for the 1982 Magarey Medal presentation, Bruce McAvaney and Sandy Roberts.
Good evening and welcome to the 1982 Magarey Medal presentation. And Sandy Roberts, welcome back to Adelaide on football's Night of Nights.
Thank you, Bruce. It's great to be back here in South Australia, and I think we can all be justly proud of the South Australians faring in Victoria at the moment, to mention perhaps just a trio. Mark Williams, of course, established himself with a Copeland Trophy win. Michael Taylor has performed admirably, captaining Collingwood this year. And Stephen Copping has also done a tremendous job. So they've acquitted themselves extremely well.
We're proud of all of them, Sandy, but let's hope the list doesn't grow too quickly.
Well, you could have a look round here, Bruce, and there could be several missing next year. One doesn't know. But if they do go, we wish them all the luck. We should bear in mind, of course, that tonight's program is an official meeting of the league, Bruce, and as such we would welcome the senior administrators and directors of the league. Gentlemen, we hope you have a good night, and also to the umpires. Of course, it is their night. They're the men who vote 3-2-1 week in, week out, to present the fairest and most brilliant player at the end of the season. And Bruce, there's one man that we should honour tonight, and it is a pleasure to honour. He's gone through 300 games officiating as an umpire. Gentlemen, put your hands together, would you, for Des Foster.
We also welcome the coaches, the captains, the players here, the past winners. I know you're going to have a very enjoyable evening.
Yes, I think it will be, Bruce. Actually, I was interested to listen to Don Rainsford's voiceover in the opening of the show, and he mentioned something about Jeff Motley's record. Now, what's the story there?
He also mentioned, Sandy, that the record might be broken tonight. When Jeff Motley won the Magarey Medal in 1964, he'd played 222 league games. He'd been the longest serving player to win a Magarey Medal. But a man who's one of the favourites tonight played his 248th game on Sunday, Michael Graham. So if Michael is successful, then Jeff Motley's record, which has stood for 18 years, will go tonight.
You're not suggesting, of course, that Jeffrey is the oldest.
I wouldn't say that about Jeffrey. And also at the other end of the scale, Sandy, Tony McGuiness will create a record tonight if he's successful. Phil Sandland in 1901, when he won, a North Adelaide player, was 18 years of age. But he was an older 18-year-old than Tony McGuiness is tonight. And if Tony can win tonight, he'll become the youngest player ever to win the Magarey Medal. And he does have one thing in common with Phil. They've both represented their state as 18-year-olds.
Well, Bruce, we'll know the answer to that in some 90 minutes' time from now. But it has been a great year for football in South Australia, and also a great year for individual performances, the sort of stuff that heroes are made of.
Russell Ebert, the only man in football history to triumph four times on this night, reached another milestone in his career when he ran onto VFL Park in a pre-season escort championship match against Carlton. That night, Ebert became the first Port Adelaide footballer to play 300 games for his famous club. Later in the season, on June 14, Glenelg's popular father figure Graham Corns, once a teammate of Ebert's, if for only a short time at Arden Street, became the first Tiger to join the illustrious 300 club. Five others made it to 250 within a fortnight of one another. Rick Davies, Bruce Winter, Peter Philippo, Stuart Palmer and Peter Vivian. For Palmer and Vivian, it was a special celebration. They created club records. Not as many gains, but special just the same, were the efforts of Neville Roberts and Greg Turbell in making it to 100. Both have had their careers on the line through injury, but Rocky after 9 years and Turbs after eight finally made it on April 24 and June 5 respectively. And running side by side with the oldies were the champions of the future. Rookies like Peter Motley, Gary McIntosh and Greg Thomas, and the teenagers Tony McGuinness, Craig Bradley and Stephen Kernahan. And what about those other record breakers, the goals and their scorers? Trevor Pearson, the first and now the only Pecker to kick 100 goals in a season. A staggering total, almost one-third of Woodville's score. 19-year-old Greg Edwards, who booted 10 and 11 in two games against Glenelg and set a Bulldog record with his 100-plus effort. Rick Davies, who sits on a tentative ton. The only thing tentative about Rick's fabulous career. Sturt's jumbo prince celebrated Jack Oatey's only farewell with 10, a club record against Woodville. And who will forget Neville Roberts's two fantastic performances? 21 goals in two games from a half-forward flank.
Marshall, McFarlane, he'll go to West and the Bays have still got a chance. He's got to keep his head. He's got to go to the goal, and that's going to go close. It's long, it's going to go
in Paul Weston's goal that went on and on and on and put the Bays into the five. The magic recipe of Davies at one end, Evans at the other as they matched mark for mark and goal for goal before 20,000 Adelaide Oval fans and a quarter of a million TV fans. And finally, the daddy of them all, the immovable object, the man who scored 9-5 times, 10 once, 100 yet again, and with 7-2-7 to his credit, is still flying high. Port Adelaide's Tim Evans.
As I said before, some great individual performances. But of course, the reason we're here tonight is to honour the winner of the 1982 Magarey Medal for the best and fairest player in the South Australian National Football League. But just before we do that, let's first of all recognise the most remarkable individual performance by any man in our magnificent game of Australian rules football. Gentlemen, I speak of Jack Oatey. From a young man who rode his push bike from Maitland to Port Victoria to get a regular game, Jack then moved to Norwood, where he was runner-up for the Magarey Medal in his second year. He played 181 games for the Redlegs, and as coach took them to three premierships in just 6 years. He then moved to Westies, where a flag eluded him, and then on to Unley for an historic 21-year term, which included seven premierships. His involvement with league football spans 42 years, 37 of those years as a league coach. And his illustrious record has seen his teams play in 31 major rounds, play off in 17 grand finals, and win 10 premierships. Over those years too, who knows how many players have come under the influence of the master, but you can be sure it would be many hundreds. The man whose competitive association with Jack has now run more than 20 years and is probably best qualified to represent all those who've played with and under Jack Oatey, gentlemen, Neil Curley.
Thank you, Sandy, and gentlemen. I think we all know Jack Oatey in a very serious manner, and I don't think too many of us know Jack Oatey from the humorous side. And I think you have to play it under the man to experience that. I remember going back in the 60s, Jack, when you selected a player to play on your grand final side, and his name was Paul Bagshaw, and the media, of course, had him under a cloud. But Baggy, of course, as you know him, you wanted to play him. And for the first three quarters, he didn't feature very well. And the final quarter, of course, he played an amazing Bagshaw quarter, and which helped you win a grand final. A few days later, I was speaking to you at the Glenelg Golf Club, where you were down enjoying a round of golf and having a quiet drink. And I said, Jack, you must have been worried at three-quarter time. Big decision to keep Bagshaw on the ground. Neil, don't tell me he fooled you. Neil, he said, I thought you would have known. I didn't let him go till three-quarter time. Well done, Jack. Of course, over the years, he's had marvellous support from a lot of people, but none other, of course, than his very lovely and charming wife, Mary.
Jack came to work where I was working, and matter of fact, I happened to type the letter that brought him down.
Uh-huh.
And that's where I first met him. I was in the office and he was typesetting. I just had a quick sneak preview look one day when I went down to see what the country boy was like.
Right. And of course, being a wife of a player and also a mother of two boys that have had long, successful careers, were there any times when you sort of got worried or about first Jack and then the boys?
No, I don't think. I mean, accidents happen.
Yeah.
No matter where you are in life, don't they?
True. And were you in favour of the boys playing?
Yes.
You supported them?
Yeah, right through. If that's what they wanted to do. Yeah.
And what's your thoughts about young lads becoming involved in a competitive sport, particularly a good solid game like football?
I think it's marvellous for them. Yeah, I would encourage it. I mean, just the character-wise, you know, what it brings out in them. I mean, you watch a young lad, you bring him in and you see him and he learns things and then you see him as he gets older and what fine men. I think it's a marvellous character builder.
No Jack Odie coaching football. That's a big gap.
Well, it's going to be a big adjustment for both of us. I mean, it's been right through our married life since I've known him. It's been football. Well, he loves football.
Yeah.
It's his life.
He does love it.
He really loves it. And I think it's... And he loves lads, as I've said before, and watching them. You know, and he gets something out of it. It's a great kick, I suppose.
Yes.
I'm proud of him, anyway.
Well, Mary, you've had a wonderful innings, and yeah, let's hope that there's many, many happy years for you and Jack left in
I'm sure
in
there
life.
Will be, Neil. It'll be marvellous to have him home.
Good.
And spend so much time with him after all these years. Shared him a fair bit, you know.
You have, yes. Well, Mary, yeah, once again, thanks very much.
Thank you, Neil.
Well, Jack, that was lovely. In what way has Mary been able to help you over the years?
Well, she's been a very good wife, of course, and her support has been, as she's just said there on the air, has been absolutely 100% towards the game itself, and naturally enough, of course, to me. And the fact that she's been able to bring up two big boys like she's had, and they've all played senior football for well over the 100 games, and myself included, of course, that we needed that sort of support. But the most interesting part of the woman's part in football is that it's underplayed considerably, I think, because most young men need the support of the family, and especially the wife or the mum in the first place. And if they get that support, I'm sure that that carries a lot of weight in their ability to perform well on the track. And it's something that is not played up at all by the media or by the clubs themselves. And I'm positive in my own mind that that support that comes from the home, either the mum or the wife, is absolutely imperative, as Mary just said, for the character of the boy playing Australian football.
Jack, do you think the attitudes and aspirations of the young men of today are any different from the attitudes and aspirations of you and your contemporaries when you began your football career?
You're suggesting, Bruce, that we're back in the bow and arrow days now? Well, I would say that they're no different at all. Everybody, of course, loves to play football once they start, and I'm positive also in my mind that those young men of today are exactly the same as they were when I first started playing. Perhaps the young man of today has a lot more going for him in different methods, a lot more support from the clubs, and I'd like to think that the coaches have spent a lot more time in making their mark on a football team, or especially on the individual player that is under his charge.
And finally, a question I've been dying to ask you. Who is the second best player you've ever coached?
Jack Odie. They're all marvellous players, and I think yesterday's game at Football Park was proof conclusive of that, Bruce, that we had a wonderful game of football provided by two very good teams.
Jack, thanks for all the pleasure you've given us, and all the best for Sturt and you in the coming weeks.
Of course, there's been a lot written and said about Jack Odie by a number of people, and I think you had to play under the man to really appreciate his dedication, his total commitment, and his sincerity to the game. And I had that privilege going back in the late 50s, early 60s, and Jack, I thank you for what you passed on to me. But I think in this man here, we have a man that, we had a Walter Lindrum that changed snooker and billiards. We had a Bjorn Borg that changed tennis. And I'm certain in this man here, we have a person who changed football completely when he went to Unley. He developed a modern type of game, and he perfected it. And of course, us coaches that have come along behind him have tried to copy it. But to you, Jack, I personally would like to thank you very sincerely for what you've done for me over the years, and also for the many fine young men you've helped develop, not only as footballers, but also as great characters, and to take their place in our society. Gentlemen, I give you Jack Odie.
Welcome back to the 1982 Magarey Medal presentation. Earlier in the night, the third and second preference votes were counted. Sandy, let's check now how the players polled club by club.
Right, Bruce, starting off with Central Districts, and young Bulldog Rover John Platten is just one of the teenage stars expected to poll well tonight. John was one of the best players in Saturday's elimination final, and others who could have caught the umpire's eye are 100 goals getter Greg Edwards, centreman Peter Krieg, and forward Michael Wright, who unfortunately is not with us tonight because he's having some exploratory surgery on a knee.
Let's check the Central's board as we go down from the top. Neil Bosanko with one vote, Peter Bythien three, down to Richard Cousins with two. Jeff Gillies has seven. Of course, Jeff not eligible. Philip Graham with five. Peter Krieg with three. John Platten doing very well with nine. Stephen Trigg having a great run with 12. And down to Michael Wright with five votes.
To Glenelg now, and young Tiger Tony McGuinness returned to form for the Bay's elimination final win over Centrals, and he certainly kicked five goals, contributing to a sound victory. Tony is one of the favourites for tonight's count, but another who should poll well is 19-year-old ruck star Stephen Kernahan, arguably the best young ruckman South Australia has produced for years.
And anybody who went to Football Park on Saturday and saw the elimination final wouldn't argue with that. Peter Carey on 12 votes. Not eligible, of course. As we go down the list, David Hulse, three. Stephen Kernahan has eight. Michael Lunnis, three. Tony McGuinness has 20. David Marshall, four. Peter Maynard, five. And down to Paul Weston on two and John Painter on four.
The North Adelaide Football Club are building a future on this year's performances with a host of promising young players, and let's hope that they do come to the fore in the future. And not without a chance in tonight's count is 21-year-old veteran rooster Greg McAdam.
McLeod up, couldn't take the mark. Through the pack comes Coop, it was for Woodville, but North Adelaide through McAdam. A long kick to goal. Gee, that's beautifully done, McAdam.
Handball out. Quickly the handball comes back to McAdam from Stringer. I think he's missed it. What's going to be close? He's got it.
North Adelaide will run it. It's across to McAdam, as easy as you like. Oh, Antwerp's got way under that ball. Here's a chance for Dietrich. Gets very high in the square. Or McAdam again. Quick as you like. Will the wisp McAdam.
What an exciting player he is, Greg McAdam from North Adelaide. So let's check the Roosters' votes at this stage. Tony Antrobus with three. Trevor Clisby with 15. Polling very well. Grenville Dietrich has four. We go down to Greg McAdam, who's polled five to date. Brendan Phillips, what a fine season he's had with nine. Mick Redden, five. John Riley, seven. Down to Wayne Stringer with two, and Les Turner also with two votes.
The winner of last year's Magarey Medal, Michael Aish, has had a somewhat unfortunate year with injury problems, but he is still expected to poll well. His brother Andrew is another player who's had a good year, while Gary McIntosh, Danny Jenkins and Neville Roberts, who's shown his finest talents, are all expected to share the votes for the Redlegs.
We won't have to look far to see the Aish votes. Paul Adler on two. Andrew Aish yet to score. Michael Aish has three. Duncan Fosdyke, two. As we go down the board, Danny Jenkins, eight. Gary McIntosh doing very well with 10. Neville Roberts has four so far. Jim Tuer, what a wonderful year he's had. 11 votes. Greg Turville with 14.
And down at Port Adelaide, there is no doubt that their champion, Russell Ebert, four times winner of the medal, will again be prominent in the count. But he could be chased home by a couple, including young wingman Craig Bradley, who's expected to take votes tonight, as will Greg Phillips, one of the finest defenders in the game.
Boot to the half forward line. Young Kapler there, Phillips over the top, fine mark.
That's a nice kick, that one. Right into the teeth of goal. Oh, up high, Phillips. A good halfbacker. Kicks to centre half for good flight by Phillips.
Richmond players kick is a nice one towards centre wing. A big leap and a fine mark. Pulled down by South Australia's Greg Phillips.
In for Ralph again. Richardson's there off good mark Phillips.
Quickly it goes in now. Going to set himself Moss there as well. Over the top Phillips. Fine defensive mark. And Sewer takes a good mark. Runs it over to Phillips. Over the half forward line. South Australia's centre half back has a long pop at goal. This is going to be close.
A little bit of rebound from the Port Adelaide centre halfback, Greg Phillips. What a wonderful player he is and what a wonderful season he's had. And Paul Belton's had a very good season. 16 votes so far to Paul Belton. Russell Ebert with 10. And Brian Cunningham just above Russell with 5. David Granger with 3. Peter Hoffner with 5. Ray Huppertz with 1. Russell Johnston, the state and Port Adelaide ruckman, with 9. Kim Kinnear, 4. Greg Phillips has 8. And Stephen Williams, 4.
To South Adelaide now, and the Panthers have had the longest drought when it comes to Magarey medal wins. In fact, we've got to go all the way back to 1953 and Jimmy Dean for their last success. But their dynamic rover, Mark Naley, was last year and once again is one of the favourites for the 1982 count.
Spiel got it away. There's Derrington, all snared beautifully by Naley. Naley goes short.
Warren going through. Naley again. Hooks around the corner. Sims in. Gets the tap away. Oh, taken by Naley. This could be the end for Sturt. Naley shoots. I think he's got it.
Back towards centre wing. Oh, a little bit of uncertainty there. Naley stole the opportunity. Unlike Port Adelaide on the leash. The Bickler perfect pass.
Going wide. Phillips up. Spoiling with Steve Bickler. Naley in again. Has been very quiet for two quarters. Pats the ball in front of him. Well, he's going to run it alone, Naley. Loves to run. Kick on the way. Gee, that's a good effort from the South Rover. Giles in, beautifully stolen Naley. Naley sidesteps Leslie. Here's a chance, South Adelaide. Naley lines them up. What a great goal, Naley. Coppy will go wide to Naley. Here's a chance for South Australia. Walker tried to trip him. Naley put it under the right foot. Through it goes.
What a marvellous player he is, Mark Naley. Runner-up last year to Michael Aish. As we go down the South Adelaide board, Graham Aitken with 4. Michael Bennett has 2. Shane Butler, 1. David Fairclough has had a very consistent season, 3. Ron Hatley was 7. Rob Hawkins, 6. Peter Ivanoff, the back pocket player, with 7. Mark Naley has 7 votes to date. Chris Reynolds, 2. And John Snabickler, 3. And Robin White with 4 votes.
Well, Sturt fans would like nothing more than to see a Magarey medal come their way in Jack Oatey's final year. But it's been a long, long time. In fact, in the last 21 years, that particular honour has eluded the Sturt Football Club. Tonight, their chances rest with the old and the new. Michael Graham has played his 248th game. Mike was fourth in the count back in 71 and third in 73. And a win tonight will culminate, indeed, a great career. At the other end of the scale, rookie Peter Motley has had a great year and must surely have caught the umpire's eye.
And what a great year the Sturt Football Club have had. Top of the ladder for so long and in the finals. So we look down the list. Neil Craig with 2. Rick Davies with 7. Eddie Fry, 7. Michael Graham with 9. Brendan Howard, 5. Peter Motley, 5. Tim Paik, 7. Frank Spiel, 9. Greg Whittlesey, 2. And Ray Wilson with 5 votes.
And gentlemen, just digressing from our boards for the moment, if you haven't already heard the news today, I'm sure you would like to put your hands together and wish Doug Thomas a happy 50th birthday for today. Happy birthday, Douglas. Doug, all I can say is that everyone else has done it today. We couldn't let the chance go by. But let's have a look at your club's chances in tonight's Magarey medal. And Ian Borchardt has had a very successful year, must surely poll well. Well, two of the club's young stars, Grant Filkey and Randall Bennett, should also poll well.
West Adelaide in the final 5 for 17 weeks. Not final, of course, they missed out in the last week. But Ian Borchardt with 8, Dirk de Jong 2, Grantley Filkey 6, Leon Grosser 6, Dexter Kennedy 4, Bruce Lindner 5, Geoffrey Morris 6, Mike Smith with 6, and Larry Watson with 1.
Well, I mentioned at the start of our telecast tonight that a number of past medalists had popped over to Adelaide today, and I'm delighted to see that a man who has joined us, he comes from Victoria, and I'd like you to make him welcome here tonight. He last won the medal 50 years ago. Put your hands together for Max Pontifex. Welcome, Max. Hope you have a great evening. Well, it's probably reasonably fair to say that the Eagles don't expect to win a medal this year, but Ian Hannah's spectacular style of play had to win him a share of votes. And Ian, it's great to see you back after those bad injuries that you have overcome and playing good football that we know that you can produce.
And Ian Hannah has done very well as we look down the board, and we'll discover in a short time. Kim Curtis has 2 votes, Robbie Enright 4, Ian Hannah second of the moment with 18 votes, and Trevor Hill 2, Dirk Inglis, another very consistent season with 6, and David Mackay 1, Robert Muir with 2, Lee Robson with 1, and Daryl Schimmelbusch with 1 vote.
A medal for the Woodville Football Club must be a possibility after their star goal sneak, Trevor Pearson, smashed the 100 barrier once again. In fact, he is the first Woodville player to kick 100 goals. And in fact, he went on to kick almost one third of the team score off his own boot. Well done, Trevor.
And as we have a look at the Woodville voting to see how Trevor Pearson, Andrew Matheson and their teammates got on, David Bolton with 10 has done very well. Paul Harradine, 5, his first year with the club. Lindsay Heaven, 4. McCormack has 2. Matheson, 3. Trevor Pearson, 6. So we go down the board, and that's the last of the vote getters for the Woodville Football Club. So we've had a look at the third and second preference votes. After the break, we'll check the leaders' board and come back with the vital first preference votes in the 1982 Magarey Medal.
Welcome back to the Old Lion Hotel and the 1982 Magarey Medal presentation. As Bruce told you, the third and second preference votes have now been counted, and so it is at this stage of the evening we have a look at our leaderboard. Tony McGuiness of Glenelg, already an early leader, and bear in mind one of the favourites for the medal, so could he have polled his votes a little too early? 20 at this stage. West Torrens' Ian Hannah is polling extremely well with 18. Paul Belton has 16. Trevor Clisby of North 15, Greg Turbell and Peter Carey. Unfortunately, gentlemen, I'm sorry you cannot be in it this year, but they have polled very well at this stage with 14 and 12 respectively. And Central's Stephen Trigg is also on the board with 12. As I said, Tony McGuiness leading, but some great polling going on for West Torrens by Ian Hannah.
Is Ian Hannah, characteristic left foot, or well put too. Torrens out of trouble and the kick's going to find Hannah. That was well played, the Eagles. They're in trouble, but they came out of it well. Hannah's handball to Hill.
Looking for brother Craig. Can't get through. Back in defence, it's Ian Hannah. Cripp takes his eyes off it. Hannah winds his way out of it. Does it well to Flanagan. Centre field, or Inglis goes past. Watch the handball, but it goes back to Hannah. He's done that well. Has one bounce. Johnson on the lead.
Johnson, Inglis, or Johnson got that one, but it only went to Hannah. Hannah breaks clear, he goes long this time. Torrens with another chance now. Phillips against Hannah, beautifully done, Hannah.
Superb judgment, a lot of courage is in right as he goes to the outer side. Hannah almost knocked up getting kicks on.
The Eagles trailing by 7-5, or taken beautifully by Hannah. Onto that left boot of his, what a player he is.
Ian Hannah. Doing very, very well indeed in the vote count so far. Ian, would you describe 1982 as your most consistent season so far?
Yes, that's 83, I think. 82, yes, you're right. Yes, most consistent season, yes.
Well, you've played under quite a few coaches at West Torrens in the short time that you've been playing league football. What has Glenn Elliott brought to the club this year that the other coaches didn't have?
Well, I guess he's brought the best out of me for this year in particular, but I think he's developing young players. I think that's what we have to look at.
Now, I believe you start training very, very shortly for 1983.
I think I've got something else to do.
Well, on that note, I wish you well in 83. I hope you're still with the West Torrens Football Club. Sandy Roberts.
Yes, thank you, Bruce. But Ian Hannah, extraordinary that. Ian Hannah has polled 18 votes to date for West Torrens, and as we said, Tony McGuiness of the Bay is leading with 20. And it is time now to begin the official count of the first preference votes. And to do that, would you make welcome, please, and it is my great pleasure to introduce to you the president of the South Australian National Football League, Mr. Max Bashir. Max.
Thank you, Sandy. As you've been told, the second and third preference votes have been counted, and the results which appear on the board are correct. It is necessary for me to remind you that players who've been found guilty of the breach of the laws of the game are not eligible to win the medal. The votes for round 7 and 16 will not be opened as the state players were not playing in those matches. I will now proceed with the counting of the first preference votes. Central Districts, P. Creagh. Central District, P. Bubner. Port Adelaide, G. Phillips. South Adelaide, R. Hatley. Sturt, E. Fry. Port Adelaide, P. Belton. North Adelaide, C. Stanbridge. Central District, S. Livesey. Central District, J. Platten. Central District, M. Wright. North Adelaide, A. Antrobus. South Adelaide, M. Naley. Sturt, M. Graham. Sturt, G. Whittlesey. North Adelaide, A. Antrobus. West Adelaide, G. Filkey. Sturt, N. Craig. Torrens, R. Muir. Torrens, I. Hannah. Glenelg, M. Lannis. Glenelg, T. McGuinness. Port Adelaide, P. Belton. Central District, P. Krieg. West Adelaide, G. Filkey. Central District, P. Krieg. Glenelg, T. McGuinness. Glenelg, D. Marshall. Port Adelaide, G. Phillips. Norwood, N. Roberts. Glenelg, T. McGuinness. Sturt, J. Derrington. Port Adelaide, R. Ebert. Port Adelaide, C. Bradley. North Adelaide W. Loken. South Adelaide G. Baines. North Adelaide W. Loken. North Adelaide J. Riley. Sturt P. Motley. North Adelaide A. N. Trobus. Glenelg, J. McFarlane. Woodville, M. Parker. Glenelg, T. McGuinness. Woodville, M. Parker. South Adelaide, C. Reynolds. South Adelaide, D. Fairclough. South Adelaide, C. Reynolds. Port Adelaide, G. Phillips. Port Adelaide, P. Belton. Central District, N. Brzanko. North Adelaide, G. McAdam. Glenelg, R. Sewer. Norwood, F. Stemper. Norwood, G. McIntosh. Sturt, T. Paik. West Adelaide, C. Williams. Port Adelaide, G. Phillips. Sturt, M. Graham. Glenelg, P. Carey. Sturt, M. Graham. And again, Sturt, M. Graham. That completes the first 60 voting papers, Sandy.
Thank you, Max. 60 first preference votes counted and has certainly caused a ripple amongst our audience. We'll take a break and then be back to check the leaderboard in counting for the 1982 Magarey Medal presentation here at the Old Lion Hotel in just a moment. After 60 first preference votes have been counted, welcome back to the 1982 Magarey Medal presentation. A little bit of pressure already creeping onto the Glenelg table as we check the leaderboard to find that their star rover Tony McGuinness has shot away to a 7-point lead with 32 ahead of Port Adelaide pivot man Paul Belton with 25. Mickey Graham of Sturt on 21, as has Ian Hanna of 21. Greg Phillips of Port Adelaide is on 20, and although ineligible, Peter Carey has polled 15 votes. But the leader at this stage with 32 votes, Glenelg's Tony McGuinness.
Someone has let him out of his road for the first time. McGuinness, Candleactus back in the forward line, and McGuinness has kicked the goal. Now Seward goes through the centre, over the top to McGuinness. McGuinness has kicked two. Drop punt, McGuinness has kicked three. McDermott again. Quickly past McGuinness into the open goal, and gee, the Bay's starting to run. Didn't take it. McGuinness, danger here, Vader to McFarlane. McGuinness, a snap, he's good, he's got it. Oh, great goal, McGuinness. Wilson, only as far as Weston, he can set it up for McGuinness. McGuinness can run in now if he can pick it up. He's on his right leg. Snap by McGuinness, it's very close, I think he's got it. Superb goal to McGuinness.
Tony McGuinness, the leader at the moment. How are you feeling?
Very nervous, Bruce. My heart's thumping up and down, but still a long way to go yet.
Well, you've achieved a great deal in your short career to date. I suppose a couple of the highlights have been to play in a grand final and also to play for your state. Which has given you the biggest thrill?
Well, they were both very, very big thrills. I was probably a little young to appreciate the grand final last year. It was just, from my point of view, you know, fantastic to play in the grand final in front of such a big crowd. The state game, you know, was probably my best day in my football life, you know, to play with all the greats of the game and to give, you know, Western Australia a bath like we did was absolutely fantastic.
You're roving to two great ruckmen in Stephen Kernahan and Peter Carey. This must give you confidence when you run out onto the field.
Yes, for sure. You know, everybody knows that Super's the best ruckman in South Australia, if not Australia. He tells me where he wants me to go, and five times out of ten it goes there. sorry, Soup. Kearns has just gone in leaps and bounds this year, and he's going to be a champion one day, and he's still got a little way to go, but you know, one day he'll be fantastic.
Tony, all the best for the rest of the count, and Max, if you'd like to continue the count now.
Thank you very much, Bruce. Glenelg, Jay Painter. Sturt, M. Graham. Port Adelaide, C. Bradley. Port Adelaide, M. Leslie. West Torrens, R. Muir. South Adelaide, M. Naley. West Adelaide, T. Burgess. North Adelaide, G. McAdam. Central District, M. Wright. Central District, P. Graham. Central District, S. Trigg. West Adelaide, R. Donaldson. South Adelaide, M. Naley. West Adelaide, J. Cantalaftis. South Adelaide, M. Naley. Sturt, E. Fry. South Adelaide M. Naley. Central District M. Wright. Sturt E. Fry. West Adelaide J. Cantalaftis. Port Adelaide R. Huppets. Norwood G. McIntosh. Central District J. Platten. Sturt P. Motley. South Adelaide R. Hatley. West Torrens R. Muir. West Adelaide J. Faulting. West Adelaide T. Burgess. North Adelaide J. Riley. Central District M. Wright. North Adelaide J. Riley. West Adelaide R. Bennett. Norwood K. Thomas. Port Adelaide I. Eckerman. Norwood K. Thomas. South Adelaide J. Snee Bickler. Central District M. Wright. North Adelaide J. Riley. Central District M. Wright. South Adelaide M. Naley. North Adelaide L. Stanbridge. Port Adelaide R. Ebert. West Torrens K. Hill. Central District P. Krieg. West Torrens K. Hill. Central District P. Krieg. Port Adelaide G. Phillips. Sturt E. Fry. South Adelaide, Jay Sneebickler. Central District, G. Edwards. Glenelg, P. Weston. Central District, G. Edwards. Glenelg, T. McGuinness. Port Adelaide, S. Williams. North Adelaide, A. Entrobus. West Torrens, D. Inglis. North Adelaide, A. Entrobus. Woodville, M. Parker. Norwood, J. Teal. And Port Adelaide, R. Harpitz. That completes the second 60 voting papers, Sandy.
Right, Max, 120 first preference votes down. We have 80 to go. Very, very tense here at the old line. We'll take a break and be back to check our leaderboard in just a moment. Welcome back to the 1982 Magarey Medal presentation. As I said before the break, over half the first preference votes have now been counted. 120 down, 80 left to go. And an interesting leaderboard, but a very handy first preference picked up reasonably late there by Tony McGuinness to hold a 10-point break over Paul Belton of Port Adelaide. A further point behind is Michael Graham of Sturt. With him is Mark Naley, who went ahead in leaps and bounds then. Greg Phillips is on 23. Wright is on 23 as well, and Ian Hanna of West Torrens on 21. We've had a look at the Glenelg table. Bruce, I wonder what the feeling's like down there at the Sturt table.
It's pretty good, Sandy, with Michael Graham doing well. And Michael, how do you read the situation at the moment?
Well, I don't read it very well at the moment.
I just said it was going well.
Yeah, I'll pull a few votes. It's good to see.
Michael, you must have a tremendous appetite for the game. You've virtually been playing full-time football for 12 years.
I love the game, Sandy, yeah.
But what about the speed that you've maintained over the years? I mean, at 30 years of age, Michael, you're supposed to be getting a little slow, but the things that you've done to Phil Gallagher this year and also to Greg Thomas have been criminal.
Well, there's nothing wrong with running. Well, Jack's told me to get the ball and you clear, run.
And run you did, and you ran magnificently on Sunday. Michael, all the best for the rest of the count and the best for the finals.
Thank you very much, Sandy.
And Bruce.
And after that, let's hand back to Max to continue the count.
Thank you, Bruce. South Adelaide, M. Naley. Sturt, P. Motley. Sturt, M. Graham. West Adelaide, I. Borchard. North Adelaide, G. McAdam. North Adelaide, S. Malloy. Port Adelaide, R. Ebert. South Adelaide, M. Naley. North Adelaide A Antrobus. Woodville M Parker. Norwood N Button. Port Adelaide G Phillips. South Adelaide P Martin. Port Adelaide R Ebert. South Adelaide R Hawkins. Port Adelaide G Phillips. Norwood G Turbull. Sturt P Motley. North Adelaide J Riley. Sturt E Fry. Port Adelaide I Eckerman. Norwood N Button. Port Adelaide I Eckerman. Central District M Wright. Port Adelaide R Johnston. West Adelaide C Lamb. Port Adelaide R Johnston. Woodville E Tahini. Norwood A Aish. Port Adelaide I Eckerman. South Adelaide D Fairclough. Port Adelaide R Johnston. Port Adelaide, I'm sorry, South Adelaide D Fairclough. Woodville E Tahini. Glenelg D Holst. West Adelaide L Grosser. Glenelg D Holst. Central District J Platten. Glenelg S Kernahan. Sturt P Motley. Port Adelaide I Eckerman. Sturt.
Many thousands of ladies and gentlemen at home, I do sincerely apologise, but we have had a major power failure, as you may well understand. started by a little fuse, which is most unfortunate, but again, I do apologise. It certainly wasn't our intention to enter the drama of the count, but if it has done that, we certainly do say sorry. We'll take a break. Hopefully things will be back in order. No, this is a commercial break. This is not a blackout. And we shall be back in a couple of minutes. Hotel, we are operating on limited resources, but it is great to be back, and we hope that we are going into your home successfully now. Before we go on with the count, we might have a look at the leaderboard. That hasn't changed a great deal since we were with you last. Tony McGuinness of Glenelg is leading on 35, but he's being pegged back. Mark Naley of South Adelaide has moved up to 31. Greg Phillips of Port Adelaide on 29. Michael Graham of Sturt is on 27, and they were four very strong fancies for the medal. Michael Wright of Centrals is on 26, and Paul Belton has just slid himself in on 25, and Ian Hanna on 24. But it's a very interesting count indeed, with Tony still leading ahead of Mark, just four votes in it. So, Max, I think we'll go straight back to you.
Thank you, Sandy. Central District, Jay Platten. Norwood, N. Roberts. Central District, Jay Platten. West Adelaide, I. Borchard. Norwood, P. Lachlan. Woodville, M. Parker. South Adelaide, R. White. Sturt, F. Spiel. North Adelaide, J. Riley. Sturt, B. Howard. Norwood, G. McIntosh. Glenelg, T. McGuinness. Port Adelaide, R. Ebert. Norwood, P. Lachlan. Glenelg, P. Weston. Sturt, T. Paik. Norwood, G. McIntosh. North Adelaide, B. Phillips. Norwood, A. Aish. Sturt, A. Zilm. Norwood, G. Turbull. Norwood, M. Aish. Sturt, M. Graham. West Torrens, P. Filippo. Sandy, we're down to the last 10 votes.
Thank you, Max. And before we go any further, with 10 to go, let's have a look at the leaderboard. 10 votes to go in the 1982 Magarey medal. Tony McGuinness, who has been the bolter, led from the start and is still doing so. Tony's on 38. Mark Naley is on 31. Michael Graham is on 30. Greg Phillips on 29. Michael Wright on 26. Paul Belton on 25. John Riley 25 and Russell Ebert 25. So I guess if we're going to be totally realistic, just about any one of these players could still win the medal. 10 votes to go. Max, let's have them now.
Thank you, Sandy. Glenelg, T. McGuinness. West Torrens, P. Filippo. Port Adelaide, C. Bradley. Sturt, G. Wiseman. Glenelg, T. McGuinness. Central District, P. Bubner. Sturt, N. Craig. Glenelg, S. Kernahan. Glenelg, R. Sewer. And the final vote is South Adelaide, P. Martin.
Congratulations, Tony. Magnificent performance. How do you feel right now?
I don't know. Oh, it's fantastic. I never dreamed of it, you know. It's a million years.
Well, Tony, I asked you earlier on tonight, what was the biggest thrill, to play in a grand final or to play for the state? How does this compare tonight?
Oh, it's just fantastic. I don't believe it. That's all I can say. It's a highlight of my career by a mile. Only a premiership would equal it.
Well, you can still do something about that in the next 3 weeks, you and the Glenelg players. Congratulations, a magnificent victory. Tony McGuinness, and back to you, Sandy.
We might just let Tony get a couple of deep breaths under his belt. We shall check our leaderboard, and we see that Tony unofficially has scored 44 votes. Mark Naley, runner-up at 31. Michael Graham of Sturt has scored 30. Greg Phillips, 29. Michael Wright, 26. Paul Belton, John Riley, both 25, as is Russell Ebert, 25. But sitting up there on top, the Young Bay Rover, Tony McGuinness, with 44 votes. And I will now call upon the president of the South Australian National Football League to officially announce the 1982 Magarey medalist. Max.
Thank you, Sandy. Tony McGuinness is the winner of the 1982 Magarey medal. Tony, would you please come forward? Congratulations, Tony. On behalf of the league, I'd like to congratulate Tony McGuinness on being awarded the 1982 Magarey medal. You've had a great season for Glenelg and for South Australia, and at the age of 18, you've certainly created some records. You possess all of the qualities which the donor of this medal had in mind when he set about making the award possible. And I sincerely hope and trust that you'll be staying here with Glenelg and South Australia in the years to come. I have much pleasure in awarding you the 1982 Magarey medal.
You'll have plenty of time to read what's on it, but not a bad game, this football, is it?
Yeah.
I'll tell you what, if you want to have a little bit of a spell, mate, we'll take a break, have a couple of really deep breaths. Don't start thinking about the next final yet either. We might go down to your coach and Bruce and just see what your teammates have got to say about your great performance, all right?
John, you must be proud of Tony.
Very proud indeed, Bruce, very proud indeed.
Well, you know what it's like to win a Magarey medal. We're not hearing from Tony at the moment, but what was that feeling like 20 years ago?
Well, we were lucky 20 years ago. We didn't have to put up with the tension, I suppose, that they have to put up with today's count. I sat at home listening to a radio. But it was a tremendous thrill, and I'm very proud of Tony. He's had a marvellous year for a young man coming into league football. He's really established himself as a great player.
Well, we've had some record breakers in the Glenelg Football Club this year. One of them was Graham Corns. We've got Tony McGuinness now, the youngest player ever to win a Magarey medal. Studley, what do you think right now about Tony McGuinness?
Well, I think he really deserves it. If you've seen Glenelg as we have over the last season, you'll appreciate how brilliant he is and how much he deserves to win it. He had a bit of a quiet patch toward the end of the season, and of course that makes you tend to forget how well he did play at the start of the season. But there's no better player and no more fitting player to receive the award, and of course we're very proud of him.
And Peter Carey, Tony McGuinness described you as the best ruckman in Australia earlier tonight. How would you describe him right now?
Well, I agree with Graham. He's had a great year and he's definitely got the potential to be the best rover in Australia.
And Stephen Kernahan, Tony said that you had the potential to be pretty good too, shortly.
I hope I'm as good as Tony is. I feel very happy for him.
Well, it's a great achievement for Tony McGuinness, Sandy Roberts.
Yes, thank you, Bruce. And what was it, 9 out of 10 or 5 out of 10 the times you listened to Soup before? You might have to change that a bit now.
Yeah, 10 out of 10 now, so.
Tone, you were a red-hot favourite, particularly down at the Bay, but has it plagued your mind much?
The last 2 weeks have been a bit nervy, especially with today was very nervy, and there's so many great players, and I thought it's been such a close season. I thought I had a slight chance, but I never dreamed it would turn out like this. There's so many great players in the game, and no idea at all.
Well, congratulations, mate. It's a magnificent performance. I'm sure John Halbert will relax the disciplinary reins just a little. The hand could be shaking, but would you mind taking that glass of champagne, and on behalf of everyone involved in football in South Australia, cheers, good luck in the finals, congratulations once again for the viewers at home and our audience here. We do apologise for that slight power failure, but thank you for bearing with us. Good night to you from the Old Lion Hotel and our 1982 Magarey medalist, Glenelg's Tony McGuinness. Good night to you all.
Australian football's highest award with 44 votes, and this morning Gillian Attrill caught up with him on the Glenelg beach.
After a night of excitement, perhaps the highlight of his career, Tony McGuinness still mustered the energy for an early morning run before work. His fitness is vital. This Saturday he's playing against Sturt in the first semi-final, and the medal win will mean added pressure on his performance. It's a lot of pressure for an 18-year-old who's only been playing Glenelg League football for a year and is the youngest ever Magarey medal winner. He's played for Glenelg all his football life, beginning in the under-10s, and now he says only a Glenelg premiership could equal the thrill of winning the Magarey medal. Last night's count did not prove to be the close contest that was anticipated. McGuinness won by 13 votes, but he was still very unassuming about his success.
Yes, I was surprised. I thought it'd be very close. There was a lot of chances. Naley's had an exceptional season. Michael Graham and John Platton and Peter Creek from Central. A lot of players were going to poll well, and I don't think the win gave an indication of how close it actually was. It was fairly close all the way through. I sort of shot 10 points ahead, and then Naley got a couple of votes, so it was close. And it was only right at the end that I sort of shot away.
I guess the most outstanding thing about this win is the fact that you're so young. Do you feel that you'll be the target of interstate interest?
Well, the drafting system that came in last year has tied me down to Geelong if I go in the next 3 years. That's always been an ambition to play in the VFL one day, and it still is. Just when I'm going to go is, I don't really think about it that much. Maybe 2, maybe 3 years, but when I think I'm ready, but I'm not quite strong enough and I don't think I'm good enough
yet. Well, what does the future hold for you in South Australia?
Firstly, most important, to win the premiership with Glenelg is number one, and to keep playing state football, is a prime motive for me, and maybe to go to Victoria in 2 or 3 years' time.
There's a happy man indeed.